you have any choice? Is this, you know, is what they've been telling us, that which is kind of the kind of accepted palaver of this era in our history, that that these companies literally are too big to fail, that if we if the Obama administration didn't go in and bail them out, and bail them out with large amounts. And if you look at what's happened in Europe, you know, people are, at least, you know, many economists are now saying that the American recovery appears to be catching fire much quicker than in Europe because of the huge amounts of money that we poured in, whereas the Europeans were more conservative in bailing out their big institutions. So,
well, I mean, all of that remains to be seen, but one of the things that we know for sure is that none of the guilty parties have been held responsible. I mean, one of the things that caused this crisis is that going back 20 years, every time Wall Street was irresponsible in using complicated derivatives or new instruments to make leverage-based investments that resulted in disasters that the United States government had to bail out, and there's a number of them. I mean, if you look at the Mexican currency bailout, there was the emerging markets bailouts that we had to do in 1998. There was the long-term capital management bailout also around then. Not only was there no punishment or prosecution of any of the individuals involved with any of those scandals, but you know, the government action in each of those cases was to reward Wall Street with gigantic taxpayer bailouts. And because of that, I mean, that was an indirect cause of everything that happened in the last couple of years, because a lot of these companies, I think subconsciously, they sort of understood that if something were to go terribly wrong, and everybody kind of knew that there was something not quite kosher about the housing market, about CDOs and CDSs, but they knew that there was going to be some kind of a government rescue if things went terribly wrong, and they were proven right in the end. And so, you know, one of the things we can say for sure is that regardless of whether everything turns out okay from now on and there isn't a recovery, this government has not gone in and conducted wide-scale criminal investigations of the major investment banks, which, you know, conducted all sorts of highly unethical business practices in the years leading up to this crisis. And nobody except for maybe one Bernie Madoff is going to go to jail out of all of this. And that already is a problem, because it's going to lead to the next bubble and it's going to lead to the next crisis after that.
What about the small banks that had nothing to do with this crisis? Is this going to squeeze them anymore when you pump huge amounts of cheap federal money into essentially rewarding these huge banks, allowing them to lower interest rates and steal customers from the smaller banks who are acting prudently?
Absolutely. Absolutely. That was one of the things that I wrote about in my story, was that while the major investment banks, when they applied for TARP money, they not only got responses right away, they got the money right away. I mean, you're talking about companies like, you know, Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley and Bank of America. They had no problem getting relief right away when they needed it. But, you know, I talked to local banking superintendents in a number of different states, and they told me that 3 months after the crisis started, 3 months after the TARP program passed, they still had banks that had not received a response from the federal government. So it's an obvious discrepancy here. You know, the government looked at the big companies and said, we have to save these guys right away, but they didn't. They didn't step in and rescue the small banks. And as you point out, for the most part, it wasn't the small regional banks that were guilty in this crisis. You know, the real cause of this crisis was, a lot of it had to do with big banks issuing bad mortgages and then selling those mortgages off to secondary buyers. Only the truly gigantic financial companies did this. The smaller banks, they weren't issuing those mortgages because a small bank does not want to hold a bad mortgage. They don't want to be responsible for somebody who's not likely to pay his money back. So they were much more prudent in the years leading up to this crisis, but they were the ones who got punished.
You know, one of the interesting political fallouts from this is what happens to the United States Chamber of Commerce. They've made a business over the past two decades of kind of shoring up the kind of monolithic unity between Main Street and Wall Street. But all of this money being funneled into Wall Street must cause some fault lines to appear in that coalition, and the Republican Party as well. You know, the Republican Party, their one issue is barking against all of these bailouts to Wall Street. What's going to happen to that coalition between Wall Street and the Republicans and Wall Street and Main Street?
Well, you know, that's a difficult issue. It's already obviously proven to be a very difficult issue for the Republican leadership. They've had a terrible time knowing which way to vote on a lot of this stuff, and we saw that this spring when there were fractures in the Republican leadership over whether or not to support Timothy Geithner's public-private investment program. There were a lot of people who initially supported, the TARP program, and then they backtracked and, decided to oppose, continuate the second tranche of the TARP program. So the Republican leadership has had a difficult problem, has had difficulty with a lot of this stuff because for precisely of the things you talked about, it has financial allies on Wall Street who supported them over the years, but at the same time, its constituents hate to see taxpayer money given away. However, that said, it's important to remember that a lot of these Wall Street companies have traditionally given more money to the Democrats, at least in the last 15 years, than they have to the Republicans. A great example is Goldman Sachs, which is easily the most powerful of all the investment banks. And they were Barack Obama's single largest campaign contributor, private campaign contributor last year. They gave him almost $1 million. They spent about three times as much on congressional Democrats last year as they did on congressional Republicans. And the part of that is just reading tea leaves and knowing that the Democrats are going to have a better year than the Republicans did last year. But that traditionally has been their MO, and it's been the MO of a lot of investment banks on Wall Street. They know that they can count on the Democrats to get something done, and they've proven to be a very useful ally to Wall Street, which is, I think, contrary to the popular perception.
Doc, just summarize, how does this alter the balance of power in Washington towards these companies?
Well, one of the things that's very true about Wall Street as opposed to other industries is that you have a situation where there are just a handful of companies are able to concentrate an enormous amount of cash. The share of the economy, the United States economy that the financial services industry now owns has about doubled since the mid 80s, since we started exporting a lot of manufacturing jobs overseas. Now the financial services industry is the reigning sector in our economy. And they really know how to play the money game better, the campaign contribution game better than any other sector, and they're also much better organized than any other sector of the economy. So they, really, the financial services industry has driven a lot of policy, both in the last administration and the current administration. A great example is this new cap and trade program that Barack Obama is pushing, which, while it's being packaged to the public as an environmental program, it's also an enormous windfall to Wall Street because it's going to single-handedly create a very lucrative new commodities market, and a lot of the banks have already positioned themselves to take advantage of that, and they've been lobbying for it very strenuously for about 3 or 4 years now, and that's why it was one of the first major initiatives that the Obama administration pushed after he came into office. So these companies have always been powerful, but now I think they're even more powerful because they've been getting an enormous amount of public money, and now they're intimately involved with the setting of national economic policy just almost by necessity because of the disasters that have happened in the last year or so.
Thank you, Matt, for joining us. Matt Taibbi is political correspondent for Rolling Stone magazine. He's also the author of several books, the most recent being The Great Derangement, a terrifying true story of war, politics, and religion at the twilight of the American Empire. Thanks for joining us, Matt.
Thanks very much, Robert. Take care.